exactly, and we're going to get started. Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon.
We're going to begin with a prayer, and I would like for us to pray this prayer together. You'll see it on the slides in just a moment. It's actually the prayer that was prayed before all of the sessions of Vatican II. And it's a prayer to the Holy Spirit. That always seems to be an appropriate thing to begin with. I have promised that I will try to speak very distinctly for the sake of the recording. I've got just a little audio device here, and that way hopefully it'll come across in the video. And so let us just remind ourselves that we are always in God's presence. And let us begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We stand before you. Let's try that again. It just went just a little bit too quickly. We stand before you, Holy Spirit, conscious of our sinfulness, but aware that we gather in your name. Come to us, remain with us, enlighten our hearts. Give us light and strength to do your will, make it our own, and live it in our lives. Guide us by your wisdom, support us by your power, for you are God, sharing the glory of the Father and Son. You desire justice for all. Enable us to uphold the rights of others. Do not allow us to be misled by ignorance or corrupted by fear or favor. Unite us to yourself in the bond of love and keep us faithful to all that is true. As we gather in your name, may we temper justice with love so that all our decisions may be pleasing to you and earn the reward promised to good and faithful servants. You live and reign with the Father and Son, one God forever and ever. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
It's great to be here with you all, and I have to say I'm really grateful that you're sticking with it this afternoon. I always feel like this time right after lunch is the time where people say, maybe I just need to go take a walk. So it's really good that we're here together. My name is Leisa Anslinger. Some of you, I think we met sort of vicariously this morning during prayer. I come from a little town right outside of Cincinnati, Ohio called Loveland. And it's a kind of a little spot of the country that still exists right outside of the city of Cincinnati. I was for 11 years a guidance counselor at a diocesan Catholic high school in Cincinnati, and then for 12 years was the director of faith formation. And in that time, in a parish in Cincinnati, we really began to realize that much of what needs to happen in parish life is to engage people in a life of discipleship. And so what we ended up doing in the parish was really embracing the call to form people at all ages and stages of life and faith. And a lot of what I'm going to be sharing with you today is some thoughts about all of that, combined with a lot of more current research and study and so on. 9 years ago, my husband and I accepted a transfer, and we were gone from Cincinnati for 4 years. And it was at that point that we decided that it was time for me simply to write and to speak full time. And so now I have the blessing of being out and about and really experiencing the church, not only in the United States, but in other places as well. And so I kind of bring that with me, too. But I have to tell you, it's just a delight to be back here in the Diocese of Reno. So I'm wondering, before we get started, how many of you are on parish staff? Do we have staff people here? My goodness, only one. Wow. She's like, yeah, I am.
She's
going to
have all the answers, too.
Do you have all the answers?
Oh, no.
So the rest of you are very involved parishioners, yes?
Yes.
Volunteer, yeah. Wow. I have to ask, how many of you were tricked into ministry the first time? I know I was, yeah. I often tell people, you know, I was in eighth grade. My family had just moved to a different town, and somewhere along the way in that eighth grade year, someone came to me and said, "We heard you play the guitar." And I said, "Yes." "And we understand that you're a Girl Scout." "Yes." "So would you be willing to play for Girl Scout Mass?" "Yes." Well, what they didn't tell me was that this was their way of getting me in the door, and they never intended to let me go. And 5 years later, as I was graduating from high school, I turned over the contemporary ensemble to my brother. But I have to tell you what a blessing that was. He is now a full-time pastoral musician. He's the director of music at the parish that serves as campus ministry for Ohio State University. And so, you know, some of us were tricked into ministry the first time, but what a blessing it is. We wouldn't want anything more for anyone, right? So what I'm hoping that we're going to do today is we're going to think about how we as individuals and how our parishes can build bridges. And I'll tell you all about how this whole idea came about, and then would like to invite us to kind of think about this together. There will be a few moments in which I'm going to invite you to talk with each other. And the one ground rule is when I say it's time to come back, it's time to come back. The hardest thing about getting us talking is it's hard sometimes to stop, but we have to do that, and so we'll do that together. And actually, I'd like for us to begin, maybe just as a big group. I'm wondering if you could just think about this with me. What are your hopes and dreams for your parish? When you think about the people in your parish and your experience of parish life, what do you hope for? What do you dream for? What do you pray for?
Tricking more people into
We know that when we get people involved, something happens, yes. Right? And so we want more of that for people and for yes. the life of our parish.
Like
absolutely.
It's a blessing that feels great, and it really is.
Yeah.
People don't realize they're scared.
That's right. First. Yes.
What do you help?
Very often people will say, you know, and it's very interesting, especially when I speak with pastors, how many of them say, you know, the pastor will say to somebody, "Could you please help with this?" And the first thing out of people's mouths is, "Oh, Father, I'm not worthy." And so that's the first hurdle, right, is getting people beyond that and helping them recognize, as Pope Francis would say, we're all sinners, you know, but yet we serve in Christ's name. So, yeah, what else? What other hopes, dreams?
We started a multicultural council at St. Teresa, and we had about 9 people on the council, and they all came up with all these really cool things that they knew from their country.
Yeah.
But then nothing was done.
Yeah.
I would like to see more richness.
Yes.
Because I think people feel threatened
yes.
by other cultures rather than embrace it as
right.
what a cool thing to learn about.
Yeah.
And so, if they're going to come out and tell you this is what we do in India, this is what we do in the world,
right.
then let's do it.
Then let's do it.
And let's expose our parish.
And I want to piggyback on that in 2 different ways. So for those of you who maybe couldn't hear, and for the sake of the recording, they drew people together to talk about the richness of their ethnic experiences, their cultural experiences from their home countries. Talked a lot about that, but then nothing happened with it. And wouldn't it be wonderful if we could celebrate that richness in our parishes? And then I'd like to piggyback on that and say, how many times do we talk things to death, but we don't exactly ever get around to doing something? And so we're going to think about that too. So there's 2 huge nuggets there of what you just said. Yeah. What else?
Yeah. We need more of our kids to stay involved.
Yeah.
I think, you know, and having them be involved.
Yeah.
I know I've been in parishes where, like, first communion, kids are doing the readings, kids are doing all this. In ours, you know, it's like, oh no, well, now they're letting them, you know, maybe bring up the Eucharist at the time. But, you know, those kids should be doing the readings. How are we going to do this? Especially since we're doing the ones who are late bloomers and getting their first
reading. Right.
Right. The ones that I work with.
Yes.
And so to really keep those kids. They should be more involved in what we're doing.
So we need to engage our children and our teens.
Mm-hmm.
And actually, that's a lot of what we're going to be thinking about in the next session, if you come to my next session. But still here, a lot of what we're going to be thinking about is how do we, you know, so many of us are worried when we look around ourselves and we see everybody that's our age. And we know that we're missing something. Yes.
Could I close this door?
Sure.
Okay.
Yes.
We opened that one.
Yeah. Okay. Great. Thank you. Anything else? Yes.
Community of inclusion.
a community of inclusion. I love that. Yeah. Everybody belongs. Everybody has a place. And everybody is of value.
Right.
We're going to talk about that in depth. That's actually where we're going to be going with this whole time together. So thank you for that. And I think that's actually a really good place to continue. I think all of us could say, when we really think about this in the biggest, broadest sense, we're talking about a desire to evangelize. We're talking about a desire to draw people to Christ and to lead them to live their lives as disciples. And then for those of us that are familiar with it, the whole big idea of stewardship, I would include that in this as well, that each of us has been given particular gifts that we need to steward in order to do that. I often tell people, I spend most of my time talking to Catholics about two of the scariest words out there, evangelization and stewardship, you know? And yet neither of those is really scary at all. You know, we evangelize by drawing each other more deeply in. And we're going to think about how might we do that in some very simple ways. So that's what we're going to hold out in front of us as sort of our big vision of what we're going to be thinking about. Recognizing that each of us is created in God's image, and that each of us has already been drawn to Christ's life through baptism. And yet, how many of our parishioners come and go and come and go and don't ever really take that baptismal experience and call to heart? And then in the midst of that, those of us that are here and the many people with whom we already serve, we are called into a role of servant leadership as Jesus shows us and leads us to live. I've been very moved by a thought about the evangelizing community that comes from Pope Francis in his pastoral exhortation, The Joy of the Gospel. And I just love Pope Francis because what he says is so deep and yet so simple and so clear. He never minces words. We don't ever have to wonder what did he mean by this. I want to share with you just a little bit of what he has said. Specifically, if you've not read The Joy of the Gospel, please do. It's very readable. If you have, this is coming largely from paragraph 24, where he talks about it. First, he talks about how each of us needs to be open to an encounter or a renewed encounter with God's love daily. This is an ongoing life of conversion in Christ. And he says that when we do that, then we're going to be sent forth as missionary disciples. We have a story to tell, and it's important that we tell that story. And we're going to do that most fully through being immersed in what he calls the evangelizing community, that community of inclusion, that community that really calls one another to live and to grow as disciples. He says that kind of a community has an endless desire to show mercy because great mercy has been shown to us. And of course, we just concluded the Jubilee Year of Mercy, but that doesn't mean that our call to be merciful ends. In fact, it's sort of like commencement. Now it's time to go live that. He says we have to try a little bit harder to take the first step and become involved in people's lives. Not in an intrusive sort of way, but in that way of accompaniment, that we're going to walk with each other on this journey of faith. And he says that the evangelizing community is going to get involved in people's lives by word and deed. It's going to bridge distances. We know that there are a lot of distances that people experience between themselves and the church, between themselves and particular local communities of the church in parishes. And we have a responsibility to be those builders of bridges. And then he goes on to say that the evangelizing community is also supportive, standing by people at every step of the way. Doing that, we're going to bear fruit, and we're going to do that by being filled with There's a wonderful book by Father Michael Himes that's called Doing the Truth in Love. And in that book, he talks about the difference between joy and happiness. He says, you know, happiness is dependent upon 1,000 external factors, whereas joy can stand alongside all of the deep richness of life. It's that kind of joy that Pope Francis is talking about in The Joy of the Gospel. Now, we know in our minds and our hearts that the parish community makes a lot of difference. We know from our own experience that, as you said, when you get involved, something happens. All of a sudden, you're connected to people. And you walk into Sunday Mass, and you know those people that you're sitting at Mass with. You know their experiences, and you're journeying with them. I want to share with you just a little bit about a body of research that really helps us to understand the real depth of what happens in parish communities. Most of you know the Gallup organization by the Gallup poll, right? It turns out the Gallup poll is actually a small part of what Gallup does. A lot of their work is working with organizations to help them to fulfill their mission in the best way possible. And so they work with schools, and they work with hospitals, and it turns out they work with faith communities. And they've done a whole body of research around what they call engagement. And in their terminology, to engage someone is to draw them into a deep sense of belonging. Because when people feel that they're deeply rooted in the parish community, they grow in their faith and express their faith in deep and wonderful ways. And what the research actually says is that when people have that deep sense of belonging, they're more likely to be spiritually committed. And that spiritual commitment gets lived out in all sorts of ways. When people are rooted in their faith community, they say that they pray every day. They're more likely to forgive when they've been hurt. They're more likely to take a stand on account of their faith, even when it's unpopular to do so. They're more likely to encourage others. I always love that. And I think to myself, oh my gosh, we need so many more of those people. And actually, we'll look at that in a few minutes. They say that when people have that deep rootedness, that deep belonging in their parish, they're more likely to invite others. Now, that makes sense, doesn't it? Because we know that the parish becomes kind of like part of our family. And so, of course, we want to bring others in. And maybe it's to Mass, but maybe it's not at first. Maybe it's to the social, or to the service project, or whatever it might be. And then eventually we kind of bring them in more deeply, right? Those engaged people are more likely to give of their time, and they're also more likely to give of their financial resources. And those engaged people are thankful people. They're satisfied with the circumstances of their lives, no matter what those circumstances might be. Here's the biggie. The research actually says, in most cases, believing doesn't lead to belonging, but belonging leads to believing. Yeah. Because we know that when we're rooted in the parish community, all of a sudden, we are predisposed to the grace of God in a different way. One of the hardest things for me in this last 9 years is that my husband and I have moved 3 times. And so it's like every time you're trying to get re-rooted, you know, and now he's home, I'm off and about, you know, he's home, so he kind of calls the parish and says, put me to work, you know. I can't do that quite as much. And so thank goodness I have one woman that early on in our time at St. Columba, which is our current parish, she said, why don't you come sit with me? And she said, I've seen you here a few times. What's your name? And so I told her. And she said, I'm Diane. She said, what do you do? And so I told her. She said, oh, I'm going to pray for you. So thank you. I need that. And I want you to know, every time I see her, she says, I've been praying for you. And she means it. And I rely on Diane's prayers. And, you know, but what a wonderful gift for me. And then she, you know, she'll say, so what do you experience out there? She's just curious. She wants to know about people like you. But what a difference that makes in our lives. So that process of engagement is really important for us to kind of wrap our heads around. And what I'd like to do is I'd like to give you an opportunity to talk with just a couple of others around you for just a couple of minutes about the difference belonging has made for you. And then I'd like to share with you what the research says helps to build belonging, and we're going to kind of go from there. So think about this for just a couple of minutes. What difference has belonging made in your life? And talk with just two or three among you. I'm going to give us like 5 minutes for the conversation, and then we're going to come back. So, real love.
Because you're moving.
First of all, I want to tell you that at my parish, where I was on staff, when we learned about all this research, we actually started to gather little groups of very involved parishioners. And we invited them to have a much more extended way that very conversation about belonging. And we asked people two things. What first helped you to really get connected? And then what keeps you connected? And now, I have to say, we were not really surprised by what we heard. What we were surprised by was the consistency of what we heard. There were certain ministries that really were kind of parishioner entry points. We had a retreat process. There was a mom's group. There was a dad's group. There was a women's group. There was a men's group. And those five ministries really were the places where people first came. And as a result of learning that, or hearing it, really, in this very consistent way, we were able to go to the people that were coordinating those very things and say, you need to understand the importance of what you're doing. And not that they didn't already know that, but by way of saying, you know, if you ever need anything, if you ever hear something that we need to know, please keep us, you know, keep us connected. Because we recognized that those were the places where people were first coming. They were first getting rooted. What the research says, that first of all, there are 12 different kind of building blocks for the process of becoming engaged that I'm not going to get into today because there's not time. But what I will share with you is what they describe as three different groups. We might think of them as three different stages on this path of engagement. And I don't think any of this will really surprise you, but I think it's good for us to know. There are some people who are engaged. My guess is all of you are included in that group because you're here, right? Those engaged people we've already described to a great degree. The engaged are the ones that they're emotionally attached to the parish community. The parish community becomes part of their family, right? There's a second group, though, and the second group are the ones that the researchers call the not engaged. Now, the not engaged, the thing to know about them is they're not negative. They really, in a lot of ways, are just waiting for somebody to pull them in. But they're less likely to invite. They're not as deeply rooted. And they're more likely to leave. And usually their leaving isn't because somebody did something, that something happened. They just drift away. They get out of the habit of coming. And they don't have someone that's kind of holding them accountable, that's calling and saying, where were you, right? And so they're less likely to invite and they're more likely to leave. They're the great majority. They're the great evangelizing opportunity because they're already with us, right? They're coming. Almost every week. And a pastor friend of mine who's done a lot of work with this research, he lives in New York and he has kind of that wry New York sense of humor. And so he had a banner made for the parish hall. And it says, really engaged parishioners stay for the final blessing. Got the picture? Yeah. Because those not engaged people are the ones that they come right before Mass starts, or maybe 5 minutes after, right? Yeah. And as soon as Mass is over, boy, they're out the door. Right? Yeah. There's a third group of people. The third group of people they call the actively disengaged. Boy, doesn't that paint a picture. Actively disengaged actually come in two forms. Some of them we just saw at Christmas time, right? They're the ones that a friend of mine calls the flower people, because they only come to church when there are flowers. Baptisms, weddings, funerals, first communions, Christmas, Easter. And then my friend Johnny say, yeah, but you have to add ashes and palms to get the whole picture, right? But for the most part, they're not with us. And we spend a lot of time trying to figure out how to bring them back, right? We're going to think about that in some very particular ways in just a little while. But there's another group of actively disengaged, and unfortunately, every organization has some of these, including in our parishes. They're the ones that are consistently against virtually everything. Yeah. They're the cave dwellers. They're the ones that are always with us all the time, and they always have something to fuss about. Right? And we worry about them too, because we're constantly trying to figure out how to solve the current fuss knowing full well that if we do 2 weeks later, there's going to be a new fuss, right? Yeah, I mean, and part of that is just kind of, there are people that are just sort of naturally negative. But we need to figure out kind of how to minimize some of that as well. So here's the important thing that I want you to hold on to for the rest of today and for the rest of your life. What the research says is, we would do better to spend a little bit more of our time, instead of worrying about the flower people and the cave dwellers, focusing on the engaged. Building on what's already engaging those of us that are already deeply rooted. Building on that. Because here's the pattern. The engaged, we reach out to the not engaged. And the not engaged are going to come over time by way of the invitation of somebody who probably right now is not engaged. I want to tell you a real quick story about this, just by way of illustration. And this one is actually kind of a bigger stretch, but I think it paints the picture really easily. I had the blessing and privilege for 10 years of directing the RCIA in my parish. And 1 year, right after Easter, I got a call from a young man whose name was Kevin. And Kevin wanted to find out about becoming Catholic. And so I invited him to come down and sit, and we were just going to talk. And so he came in, and I said, "So I'm curious, what brought you here?" And he said, "Well, actually, a friend of mine invited me to come to Easter Sunday Mass." I'm thinking to myself, okay, I might bring friends to Mass, but I don't know that I would bring them to Easter Mass, you know? I mean, we know what Easter Mass is like, right? Yeah. And it happened that our parish church had a balcony that sat 300. It was actually part of the worship space. And so Kevin and Ken, his friend, had arrived at like 5 minutes to Mass time on Easter Sunday. And they managed to get seats in the very last row of the balcony. I was amazed that they even got seats, right? And the interesting thing, first of all, Kevin says, it was like you were all one body. Yeah. He said, you knelt, you stood, you made the sign of the cross, you made the sign of the cross a different way. And he said, I was just so taken because it was like you all knew what to do. And he said, but the thing that really got me was, after Mass, Ken was standing in the lobby of the church, and he was talking to all of these men. And he said, and I started feeling like I want what he has. Yeah. It turns out, and here's the pattern, Kevin's friend, had been a marginal Catholic. For years, he had been one of those really, like, not engaged, almost actively disengaged people. And he had been invited during Lent to come to our men's retreat. So those men that he was talking with after Easter Sunday Mass were his retreat brothers, and that's why he came to that particular Mass. And there's the pattern. The men at the retreat drew Ken in, Ken drew Kevin in. That's the way it works. Now, we all know this, don't we? Yeah, but we need to really think about that, because we all in our lives, I know it, no matter who we are, we know people that are right now either not engaged or they're actively disengaged. We know the flower people. There are sons and daughters and brothers and sisters and neighbors and co-workers, right? And what are we going to do? We're going to figure out how to build bridges to them. And that's why we're talking about this together. Because we know that there are a lot of people who are simply missing. And it's not solely younger adults, but it is most prevalent among our younger adults. And I want to share with you just a little bit about that, just so that we can kind of wrap our heads around this. You know, while 1 in 3 Americans were raised in the Catholic faith, fewer than 1 in 4 today describe themselves as Catholics. Mm-hmm. Again, no surprise, but I think it's important for us to know this. 10% of Americans describe themselves as former Catholics. And in fact, the largest religious group in the United States still are Catholics. But the second largest group are former Catholics. Now, I think the good news here is these are people that still, in one way or another, identify with the Catholic Church and with the Catholic faith. And I think that's really important for us to recognize. It is much more prevalent among younger adults. Again, not completely, but younger. Now, I want to ask us just a couple of questions, because I have to tell you, a few years ago, I was invited to do a workshop about the group of people that have come to be known as the spiritual but not religious, right? Spiritual but not religious is sort of this Western world phenomenon, not solely among Catholics by any stretch of the imagination. So I started doing a little bit of reading around that, as well as the ones that the researchers now call the nuns, N-O-N-E-S, because on the survey when asked what denomination are you, they answer none. Okay? So we have two groups of people that I want us to become familiar with just a little bit, because I think it's going to help us to think about all of this together. Those spiritual but not religious people, I just show of hands, true or false, what do you think? The spiritual but not religious are not members of congregations. How many of you would say that's true?
True.
No, actually it's not. Yeah, that was the big surprise for me. That the majority of folks who consider themselves spiritual but not religious are actually members of parishes and churches. And in fact, about 20% of Catholics say that. So, you get the idea. And again, this is not entirely a young adult phenomenon, but it is largely our younger ones who have become, and it's not only about organized religion, it's about all institutions. They become very suspicious of institutions. And when we think about it, that makes a lot of sense, doesn't it? Because we've got a lot of institutional issues that have emerged in the last 15 years that would cause people to be suspicious. So, second of all, most people who identify themselves as spiritual but not religious do not believe in God. I think that one's sort of a giveaway. No, that one is false. Most of them do have a very rich spiritual life, or they're looking for a rich spiritual life. It's just not always being expressed within the institutional church. Let's try another one. Again, true or false. Those who are not religiously affiliated are most frequently found among younger adults. We've already said, yeah, that is definitely the case. How about this? The unaffiliated, those nuns, are a stable yet growing segment of the population. What do you think, true or false?
True.
Yeah, actually that one's false. And we'll find out about that in a minute, because that was kind of the other, maybe surprise, that we need to think about. So here's just a little peek into these two groups, the spiritual but not religious, more common among women than men, slightly, and more common among younger adults. The majority are religiously affiliated. About 60% of the spiritual but not religious actually are members of denominations and parishes. The nuns, it's now over 30% of adults under the age of 30 are unaffiliated. And as we'll see in a moment, this slide keeps saying I'm going to fix this. So you can just do it this way. It gets stuck. Come on. Do it this way. It's just moved there. No? It's really stuck. There we go. All right. The good news is, still the majority of people who are baptized within the Catholic faith remain Catholic. That's the good news. 68%. And keep in mind, this is not only a Catholic thing. This is really all mainline Christian denominations, and now it's also coming to be a thing that the evangelical churches are experiencing. They were a little bit later to the experience, but nonetheless, it is happening to everyone. Here's the really just disturbing thing from my perspective. Most who decide to leave their childhood faith do so before age 24. So whoever it was that earlier talked about the need to keep our kids, yeah, boy, is that ever the case. We've got to be engaging people very young and then keeping them engaged. Yeah,
Sorry, but to go back a few slides, I didn't get whether the answer was true or false about whether they believe in God.
Mm-hmm. They do.
They do.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you. And that was both the spiritual but not religious, and the nuns?
The nuns vary. Some of them would identify themselves as either agnostic or atheist. The spiritual but not religious are really the what we would think of maybe as seekers. They're the ones that are, they have a real desire for a deep spiritual life. They're just not expressing it in a way that is kind of within the institutional church, even though many of them are with us. And those of you who will come to the next session about parents, when we think about this from the perspective of the parents, then we really begin to realize that many of our parents that we're interacting with are among these young adults who are spiritual but not religious, and therefore that's the environment in which their children are growing up. And so all good things for us to keep in mind. But I think this is really helpful for us to know, because we get the sense that people come and maybe they go and there's something going on there, right? But we also know from our earlier conversation that the more we can draw them in, the more we can engage them, the more likely it is that they're going to grow in their faith in deep and wonderful ways. The reality is that kind of coming and going and coming and going is really a symptom of something that's much bigger. They're not connecting to the faith community in the same sort of way, and because of that, they're also not connecting with their faith in the same sort of way. And all important things for us to think about. Here's the thing about the stable but not religious, or stable but growing. It is a growing group, but it's not a stable group. And this is the other thing that I think is really important for us to kind of get our bearings around. The unaffiliated, those that are, you know, really on the far fringes of kind of coming Christmas and Easter and so on, they have the largest retention among any of the religious groups. So keep in mind, we have now a second or third generation of unaffiliated homes. You know, people that have grown up in homes where religious experience was not part of their family life. And those young people, many of them will say, I always felt like my friends who went to church had something that I didn't have. And now that I'm a younger adult, I can make the choice for myself. And so they come to us. Not in as great a degree as the ones that are leaving, but there is this very permeable religious landscape. And again, not only the United States, but all of the Western world. I, not long ago, had the opportunity to talk with some people in a very remote diocese of Canada about all of this, and so I dug into their statistics, and it's very, very similar. I've been to Australia, and their statistics are actually much bleaker than ours, if we want to think about it in that way. So we all have this dynamic that is very, very permeable, and good for us to know. So with that in mind, I'd like for us to shift our attention ever so slightly and think about, so what is it that people are looking for? We know that we've got this experience of many that are with us, but they're not really with us in a deep way. And we also know we have a lot of people that aren't with us regularly. What are they looking for? What I'm going to share with you is largely about younger adults. But we all know that what's good for younger adults is good for everybody, right? And again, because so much of what we're describing is about the younger adults, I think it's important for us to know this. So what are people looking for? Gross simplifications, but I'd like to focus on three different things just to make this manageable. And the first is this: people are looking for a spiritual dimension in their lives. God has created us with a hunger, an inborn hunger for God. That is part of who we are as human people. Years ago, I had the blessing of hearing Sister Cheryl Erb speak. Sister Cheryl at the time worked for Renew International. And she was doing a training, and she said something that I've never forgotten. She said, you know, people are thirsty for a Lord. And Jesus tells us that we're to be the salt of the earth. And so maybe we need to add a little of that salt so that people will recognize their thirst. Well, I think there's something there. We need to add that salt. You know, a lot of us worry about talking too much about our faith with our children or our grandchildren or our neighbors or whatever. And maybe it's not so much that we harp and harp and harp, but we also don't want to hide our light under the bushel basket. We need to be those people that do have a way of witnessing to the power of God in our lives in order for others to be drawn to Christ. People have that need for a spiritual dimension in their lives. David Kinnaman, who is the president of the Barna Group, Barna does a lot of research around younger adults, and he said this: they, meaning younger adults, see spirituality as connected to all of their life, not a compartment within their life. We need bridges, there's that word again, between Monday to Friday and Sunday. Boy, is that ever the case. And I found it just absolutely fascinating. I talked this morning about Archbishop Tobin, Cardinal Tobin, who was installed as the Archbishop of Newark yesterday. And he talked about how everybody's all hung up on these big, you know, sort of hot button topics. And yet when people ask him, what does he think the most threatening thing is to our faith in this era, he said from his perspective, it isn't that. It's kind of this lukewarmness in which we're not bringing our faith into our daily lives. So that even those who do go to Mass on Sunday, you know, then the rest of their week is just caught up in other stuff. Catechetical people have been talking about this for years. But it's important that we continue to think about this. We need bridges between Monday to Friday and Sunday. So people have this need. They're looking for a spiritual dimension in their lives. They're also looking for that personal connection. You know, that Gallup research really highlights for us this need for this relationship among people. You know, I had the blessing of meeting a number of the people at Gallup that were responsible for this research. And I shared with one of them one time when my husband and I moved to Indianapolis 9 years ago. My husband realized that was, you know, he was going to spend a lot of his time at home alone because our children were both grown and I was traveling all the time. And so he literally called the parish and said, put me to work. And as you can imagine, the parish went, ha, okay. What have you done in the past? And he said, well, I've been an RCIA sponsor. And they said, great. Would you be an RCIA sponsor? Sure. And within just a few weeks, they said, well, would you be willing to coordinate the sponsors? And he was like, I could do that. And then one weekend, I called home and said, how are things going? He goes, you know, it's really good. I met some men that are in the Knights, and I'm going to join the Knights. And I went, really? And my husband's I'm introverted. He's really introverted. He says, because I want other men that I can serve with. Okay, great. And then finally one Sunday I called and said, so how are you doing? And he goes, I'm fine, but I think I'm going to have to learn how to say no. So what did you say yes to this time? And he said, well, the DRE stopped me after Mass this morning and said that they really need a fifth grade catechist. And so he said yes. Now the wonderful thing is that's really the one that stuck. Now, 9 years later, my husband is a seventh grade catechist, and he really pours his heart and soul into what he's going to teach these young people. And he starts every year by saying, you know, if you don't remember anything that I've said, I hope that you will remember one thing, and it's that I love Jesus, and I hope that you will too. What a
great, great feeling.
Isn't that awesome?
Oh,
wow.
And I've been doing 7 years, so I took my son one day and I sat down in the class and I haven't left. You know, it's a great feeling. I enjoy it every year with my kids. The kids that are getting older, 7 years later, I say hello to them. They come to our class because they make our class really enjoyable.
Yeah.
And I really, excuse me, I'm not going to say this, but I really hate to hear people say, oh, you know how those young kids are. You can't talk to them. Oh, yes, you can.
Yeah.
You really can. It's us that we can't talk to.
That's
you know,
right.
And don't get me wrong, I mean, we're all human, but Yeah, it's a great, so your husband's
it's
doing
amazing.
Good. He's doing really well.
So I have to tell you, so, you know, because most of my ministry is on the weekends, I will go 3, 4, 5, sometimes more weekends without being in my home parish. And so the first year that I traveled, I had like 5 weekends in a row that I was gone. And on the 6th weekend, I came home and I went to Mass with my husband. And after Mass, he's flitting and floating, and he's got his little notebook so he can make notes about what he said that he'll do and people's phone numbers and their email addresses. I am not making this up. I found myself backed against a wall, foot tapping, arms folded, thinking to myself, couldn't we just go home? And all of a sudden I realized, oh my God, I've become not engaged. It happened. So, now, for me, it wasn't anything about the parish or its people. It was just that this is my life, right? But what? So I asked one of the guys at Gallup, I said, what do you know about this? And he said, here's the thing. Anecdotally, what they believe is that we have about 6 weeks. We have about 6 weeks from the time someone comes to us for the first time to the point where we need to get them engaged before they slip into the business of being not engaged. We can still engage people, but it takes more to move somebody from non-engagement to engagement than it does simply to engage them from the get-go. And I think that's really helpful for us to know. People are looking for that personal connection. I'm going to skip through this real quickly just for sake of time, but I want to share with you. I actually developed a bit of a survey. And this is not the random anonymous survey like Gallup does or the Pew Forum. This is actually much more like a large focus group. But with over 4,500 responses now, it's a really large focus group. I created a survey around spiritual needs because most of the people that have either become unaffiliated or the ones that have pretty much left entirely, the ones that move from one church to another, right? The vast majority of those people will say they didn't feel their spiritual needs were being met. Now, we can hear that and we can think, how can that be? We have Mass, we have reconciliation, we have all of these things. How can that be? And yet again, we know that there's this disconnection that happens. So I created a survey around that, and one of the first things that I ask is, what helps you grow spiritually? Because the folks at Gallup have taught me, if you want to know something, ask it. I love this. Against all faith or all age groups, participation in Mass. Thanks be to God. Now, keep in mind, these are people that are motivated enough to see something in the parish bulletin or hear an announcement, go home, go online to answer the survey. Okay, so these are really already connected people for the most part. 86% answer Mass. That means 14% of those very motivated people out of a list of 14 check as many as apply, don't even check Mass, which just kind of paints a picture. Daily prayer, belonging to my parish. I saw that and I went, oh my gosh, out of the mouths of our very own parishioners, there it is. And here's the one that I love, having good friends who share their faith with me. Makes a lot of sense, doesn't it? That helps us to grow. Now, among younger adults, belonging moves up. So it's Mass, belonging, prayer, and friends. And among teenagers, no surprise, it's Mass, friends, belonging, prayer. I'll give you a web address at the end, but you can see it up there at the top. If you just go to CatholicLifeAndFaith.net, and there's a tab that says evangelization. You can actually go on, you can take the survey yourself, you can download the survey if you'd like to share it with others, and it's available in both English and Spanish. If you would like to give it to your parishioners, let me know and I'll add your parish name to the parishes that people can choose from, and then at the end of your survey time, I'll give you a report of your parishioners' responses. So those of you, all of you but you, that are, you know, wonderful parishioner leaders here, go back to your parishes and talk about this, because I think it's really helpful for us to hear from our own people. I ask things like, what helps you in your parish to grow in your faith. What helped you find meaning or purpose in life? And I keep saying, this is going to be the title of my next book, Family, Faith, and Friends, in that order across all age groups. I think it's just fascinating. You know, there's something really important that happens in our families. And I love the focus of the synods that have been happening around family, because it's really important for our people. And then for those who said that their faith needs strengthening, I actually asked a question about what would you participate in? So not what would you like, but what would you really do? Number one response, having a faith mentor. Now, I have to say, I added that in that way because I didn't want to say spiritual director. I thought, first of all, a lot of people wouldn't even know what that means. And second of all, that might be off-putting. But rather, just to have a faith mentor. What would it be like? Maybe it wouldn't change anything at all, but maybe it would, to say to our confirmation sponsors, think of yourself as a mentor. What would it be like to say to couples that are helping other couples to prepare for marriage, think of yourself as a faith mentor. Would that change anything? Baptism, new parishioners, in so many different ways. What would it be like simply to say, you know, during Lent, we'd love to offer the opportunity for people to mentor each other. Younger adults especially want what they call reverse mentoring opportunities. In other words, they have something to share. Just because they're younger doesn't mean they don't already have experiences that they could bring to a relationship. So what would that look like? Maybe it wouldn't change anything. I think it could change a whole lot of things. So people are looking for that personal connection. And then they also want to be able to contribute to mission. They want to be able to give of themselves. Yes.
So on your first one where it says participation in Mass,
yeah.
That's different than attending Mass, right? It's actually...
Yeah, I actually worded it that way for a reason, because in my mind there is something really different about saying I'm participating. My guess is that's why the 14% didn't answer that, because they're going, well, I come to Mass sometimes, but I can't really say that I participate. And I felt like just by saying it that way, I could plant the seed that this is what we really should be doing. So, yeah, but my guess is that that's some of the reason for the response the way that it is. So, what do we do about all of this? Here's what I'd like to suggest. I believe that we need to become builders of bridges. That's why I called this workshop what I did, and that's why we're thinking about this. And at this point, I really want to share a story with you about this particular slide. I have found over the years, and I think the older I get, the more I find that I've become a very visual person. And when I'm thinking about new stuff, a lot of times I need the image before I can do the rest of the thought development. So I had spent the better part of an afternoon finding all different kinds of images of bridges. And I had just put this slide together, and for me, each one of these says something a little bit different about this process. And my husband came and stood behind me and you know, as he's coming home from work, and he said, "What are you doing?" And I said, "Well, I'm working on something new." And he goes, "About what?" And I said, "Well, about how we need to build bridges to each other in our parishes." And he went, "Huh." And I could not make this up. All of a sudden, I thought to myself, oh my goodness, he's a bridge engineer. That's what he does. He's a structural engineer who designs bridges. But I have to tell you, having that thought about this gave me a whole different train of thought about this, because I know what Steve does. And what Steve does is he doesn't just go putting a bridge up. He has to figure out how far deep do we need to put the foundation in order for this thing to stand. Where are we going? Where are we trying to go? They literally talk about what is the approach that we need to take. They look at, are there any obstacles in the way? And sometimes there are obstacles. My favorite of all the projects that Steve has ever worked on, if you really get interested in this, go to YouTube and search Milton Madison, the Milton Madison Bridge. My husband had a very small part on this. He worked on the approach for one of the sites. Milton Madison Bridge is crossing the Ohio River between two little towns, Milton, Kentucky, and Madison, Indiana. And in that particular instance, they could not move the road. They had to leave the bridge where it was, but the old bridge was there. And they couldn't take the old bridge out until the new one was ready, because the next nearest bridge was 40 miles away in this very kind of hilly, mountainous area of that part of the country. So they left the old bridge in place, and they built the new one in sections, and they ferried it across the river, and they built the bridge. And then they took the old one out, and then they moved the new one in place. And what you can see on YouTube is the time-lapse video that shows them moving this bridge. I sent it to a friend of mine who said, oh my gosh, look at how many people it takes to build a bridge. But when we think about it from that standpoint, in our own lives, but also in our parishes, we need to think about, if we're going to build those bridges, what do we need to be thinking about? Are there obstacles? What are we trying to lead them to? Bridges go both ways, right? So sometimes we've got to go out, and sometimes we're going to be drawing people in. And that's really important for us to think about. Pope Francis said this, "The Lord made bridges. Christians who are afraid to build bridges and prefer to build walls are Christians who are not sure of their faith, not sure of Jesus Christ. Build bridges and move forward." I love that. It's kind of like, okay, we got our marching orders here. Build bridges and move forward. And you know that the word pontifex, from which we get pope, actually means bridge builder. So all of us who are connected to the pope are called to be builders of bridges. And as I've already sort of led us down this path to think about, bridges are built person to person. There are some systemic things that we can do, no doubt, and lots of conversations to be had about that. But when it comes right down to it, those early bridges especially, it's going to be a person-to-person thing. It's going to be Ken calling Kevin and saying, why don't you come to Mass with me? And then Kevin calling and entering into the RCIA and being given a sponsor and going through the process. And then Kevin got involved. And then he brought, you know, that's the path. It's a person-to-person experience. So, all of this taken into account, I'm leading up to something, and it's this. I think there are three initial bridges that each of us can build and that our parishes can build. But I'd like for you first just to think about this from your own personal experience. There are three bridges that each of us can build. The first of those is welcome. We need to make people feel at home. You know, we talked about how when we are really deeply rooted in the faith community, it feels like family. And that's what we need to help others to feel like. Very easy example. That first Saturday that Diane came and reached out and said, why don't you sit with me? It would have been really easy for her to sit and talk with Pat, who she always sits at Mass with. But instead, she reached out and she drew me in. Then I met Pat. And now if Diane's not there, I sit with Pat. You know? But so often we come into Mass and the first thing we do is we gravitate to the people that we know. And we're kind of oblivious to the people that might be looking, that might be ready. Or maybe they're not quite, but at least if they felt like we really want to include them, we value them as children of God. What a difference that could make. Our daughter and her husband are the parents of our one grandchild. I'm a grandma. All my friends told me this was going to be an experience of a lifetime. Oh my gosh, is it ever. But Carrie and Nathan moved to Nashville, Tennessee last year, just about this time. And they went to the parish nearest them. No one greeted them. No one said hello. The first time Patrick squirmed, they could see people kind of looking over their shoulders like, who is this child? They never came back. They found another parish. It's that simple. All it takes sometimes is just a, hi, we've never met, you know. And I always tell people, you know, we do run the risk of somebody saying, well, I've been a parishioner here all my life. I don't know where you came from. Great. You know what? My name is still Leisa, and it's wonderful to meet you. That's all it takes sometimes. We need to make people feel welcome. Second of all, second bridge, friendship. You know, we talk a lot in church circles about relationship. Relationship can be a little bit scary for people. Friendship, not so much. You know, think about the parents of the children that are preparing for First Holy Communion. You know, we all in our parishes have those meetings of parents. And very often the parents are trudging in, they've had to find a babysitter, they had to rearrange their lives, they skip dinner in order to get to the parish, and they come and all they want to do is get through it and go home. But what an amazing thing if we just say for 5 minutes, introduce yourself to the person that's next to you. I actually do a thing that I've done in parishes sometimes that I call How to Help Your Child Grow Up Catholic. And the amazing thing is that every one of those meetings, at the end of the night, those parents are trading email addresses. And they're saying, can I connect with you on Facebook? They want to be, they need that personal connection. So what's it like to draw people into just simple friendship? What a difference that can make. And then thirdly, the third bridge is that of sharing. We need to help one another to get really comfortable sharing our faith experiences. What a difference faith makes in our lives. And we need to give each other that opportunity to share of our talents, to share in ministry together. Knowing that most of us were drawn in, maybe we weren't tricked in, but we certainly didn't really realize what was going to happen by way of our involvement. And yet we know.
Yeah. Sharing, real quick, guys. I've seen it in a lot of places. At work, mainly, all of us usually work someplace. Don't like to talk about religion because people are not religious. But I don't care. I have a church meeting to go to. They know everybody at work has them coming here this weekend.
Yeah.
They know we have the nights. I'm involved in the nights. They know I do a lot of volunteer work. But I'm not embarrassed about it. Period. I'm not embarrassed. They'll walk up to me later, maybe one-on-one, and ask me, Charles, you know, what do you do when you do go to these nights meetings?
Yeah.
When you do go to church?
Right.
Some say, well, I just started going to this church. You know, they don't know how to open up. They're scared to open up because we're the ones who are going to point the finger. Or people will point the finger at it.
Right.
So that's where sharing really, I feel, comes a lot of. Maybe they're not Catholic, maybe they're whatever.
Right.
But at least they're starting to share and opening up to you. And maybe they want to go to your church. Who knows? But it starts a lot right there with yourself.
Exactly.
Us as a person.
Exactly. And actually, that's one of the reasons why when I really started thinking about this process of bridge building, I wanted to think about it in a way that we could each as individuals think about, as well as our parishes. You know, and you could certainly think about those three bridges in terms of the experience of your parish. And you know where people feel welcome and where they don't. You know where people are drawn into relationship and where they're not. You know where people are invited to share and where they're not. But start with us, because we all have those things that we can do together. So I'd like to give us let's just do this. Let me give you some contact information. Let me do that first. And then I'll give you some time just to think aloud for the time that we have left, because I don't want to lose this opportunity just for you to know. If you ever want to get a hold of me, go to catholiclifeandfaith.net or go to bridgetofaith.net. Both of those websites are mine. The Bridges one is specifically about this, and we've actually developed, a colleague and I have developed some workbooks, and I always tell people I don't write books to make money, I actually write books to serve people. But I brought a couple of samples just so you can see. The first one, the one that this whole thing has been about, is actually in English and Spanish, and has all kinds of worksheets and so on. But what I want you to know is that on both of those sites, I have tons of stuff just for you to take. It's just there for your use. Anything that you think might be of help. I told Monique I'm going to give her the PDF of all of the slides for all three of the things that I've done this weekend here so that she can share those with you. But if you go to the website, you'll find all kinds of other PDF slide decks of other presentations, a couple of videos that you can use in parish meetings and so on. So CatholicLifeAndFaith.net, BridgeToFaith.net, those Bridges workbooks, I've got a discount code there. I didn't bring books to sell with me. It's actually better all the way around because this actually covers your shipping, and so you end up getting free shipping that way, and I'm not shipping books here and there and everywhere. Unfortunately, they don't let me customize the discount code, so it is what it is. I'll leave that up there. I'm wondering, do you have anything that you're wondering about? Questions, thoughts, wonders, insights? What do you think?
Are you going to go build bridges?
When you talked at the beginning, you talked about the five groups, right?
Yeah.
You didn't mention the impact of youth ministry. Do you know about that?
Actually, I do, and thank you for asking that, because that actually is directly related to one of the things that I said, and I just didn't know if I was going to have time. There is a wonderful sociologist from the University of Notre Dame, Dr. Christian Smith, that has done a lot of look at teens and young adults, and specifically, what is helping the ones who stay to do so? And it's really interesting. His first study, they called the National Study on Youth and Religion, and this was about 15 years ago, and he and his group of sociologists talked with, it was actually an interview process, with teens of all different religious experiences. And at that time, the big aha was, if our parents aren't going to live it, we're not likely to live it. And so youth ministers really started kind of getting their heads around, oh my gosh, it's hard enough to engage the teens. Now you're telling me that I have to engage the adults as well. But the teens were very clear in, you know, don't drop me off at the parish and think that it's going to be like pixie dust. Now they've gone back and they've talked with those same young people as what they call emerging adults. So in those young adult years. And they're looking at what are the things that are helping the ones who stay? What happened with them? And they're saying, yes, in fact, their parents really were important, but so were the other adults in the life of them. They need to know that they're surrounded by a community. And what they're really looking for, and I think this comes back to that kind of spiritual but not religious experience, of they want to know that this is a viable, genuine way to live a life. They're looking for integrity, and so they need to be surrounded. They're young people who have been taught to pray. They're young people who have been taught to read the Bible. And this one fascinates me. They're young people who either they or someone that they know has experienced something of the miraculous. In other words, when we have those experiences of God's presence in our lives, we need to be talking about it. Because our young people, and all of us, you know, we know how inspiring it is to have someone say, I experienced God's presence powerfully in this moment. Our young people need that even more. The other thing that Dr. Smith said is, and I had the blessing of hearing him do a live presentation as they were concluding all of this research, and he said, in more or less words, many of the younger adults are saying, I don't know if I believe everything that I was taught. I don't know that it's really important to go to Mass on Sunday. But I want my children to be given what I was given. So they're bringing their children for sacramental preparation, and they're keeping them with us about through the point of confirmation. And then they're saying to the young person, now it's your decision to make. So we really have a window there to evangelize not only the young people, but their parents. And youth group, of course, is a big part of that. So, you know, thank you for asking that. What else? Anything else that you're thinking, wondering? Yeah.
What then happens when they're talking about pulling back confirmation to a younger age? That kind of closes down that opportunity.
It does and it doesn't. And I'll tell you a real experience that I've had with this in the Diocese of Saginaw, where they've confirmed at about age or grade 3, now for over 20 years. They've really focused on youth experience, youth ministry experience, and I've been in a number of parishes there, and their young people are very involved. But what they've had to do is they've had to look at the whole experience of faith at all ages, and they've had to say, we've got to find ways to engage our adults, because the adults are the ones that are going to witness to this ongoing life of faith, and then the young people are just going to grow up thinking, this is what we do. This is who we are. So it's not so much, I don't think it's so much about the age of reception, it's what are we doing whenever we confirm to really help people to see this as a way of life. And then we move on. I was confirmed in fifth grade, you know, and I was actually old for my age because my family had moved a number of times, so I was the last one in my grade to be confirmed. Everybody else was confirmed much younger. It was just the way things were done then. you know. So it, I think it's just a way of thinking about the whole forming people in faith. Yeah.
Yeah, I'll share something because I saw community in our diocese is looking forward, because I was part of the Senate, knowing that all these changes are going to be coming in the next couple of years, where we're going to confirm at a younger age. That was my concern. Though I was for it, it's still my concern. So I started a program at our parish this year, anticipating the next 2 years it's happening. I call it YOYO. It stands for young and old. It's an intergenerational learning. We have 75 kids in the process and probably about 35 adults. When I had signups for all the different clubs, we have photography, music, choir, guitar, arts and crafts, sewing, cooking, that are going to branch off into other things in the parish as well. But adults came and said, well, I would like to learn that. Can I sign up to be the student? And so now I have from 8 years to 80. And it's growing, and people are excited, and the adults as well as the children are excited. So.
And you know, the really cool part about that, I love that, because those people are going to see each other not only at the parish, but at the grocery store and the athletic field, and all of a sudden, it becomes that inclusive community again in all kinds of ways. I am so sorry our time is up, but I'm grateful that we had this time together. I hope you'll stay in touch. Let me know. Both of those websites have a contact us button that all comes to me. I'm really good with email.
Thank you.
Take care. Thank you. Off you go, and I'm going to go into a different room.